Good morning and a very warm welcome to Glebe Chapel online service. I don't know if you're watching this live or whether you watch it at some later date, whether you sit down at proper church time and watch the service, or whether, like me, you're busy in the kitchen and you have the service on in the background and listen to it. However you watch or listen to the service, you're very welcome. Thank you for joining us. Today, we have a sermon later on Philippians 4, which is by Rupert Abbott. And then Angie is doing the kids' slot. And our prayers are being led by Jan Comer. And in between, there's all sorts of singing, so you can join in with worship and praise God in your own way. I've been thinking about welcome this week, because a couple of weeks ago I managed to go to church, actual real church. It wasn't our church, it was a church on an island in the City Isles. The sign on the door I walked past several times said, "Service at 9 o'clock, everyone welcome." I thought that was encouraging, so I got out my tent and I was there for 5 to 9. Did I feel welcome? Well, this is what happened. I got to the door, somebody in a mask, couldn't see if they were smiling, said, "Have you got the track and trace?" I said, "No, don't have a smartphone." So I had to sign in. And I went into the church, and it was a little church. There was a handful of people there, very well spaced out. And the person who had met me at the door said, are you able? I thought, what does that mean? She said, "Could you manage the stairs?" I said, "Oh yeah, I could manage the stairs." So she sent me up the stairs to the dusty balcony at the back of the church, all by myself. Nobody joined me up there. There was a few more people, well spaced out in the church, and the service began. And it was a good service. It was an Anglican service, and I enjoyed it. I couldn't sing, but I could listen, and I could think, and I could reflect. When I left, shook hands with a couple of people, but nobody said anything. Did I feel welcome? Well, no. To be truthful, not really. But I was glad I went. And I was thinking about, here we are, watching the service online, but very soon we'll be back in church together. I wonder how you feel about that. Oops. Do you feel like you're somebody who belongs in church? Will you be happy to go back and see everybody again? Do you feel like an insider? Do you feel like an outsider sometimes? Perhaps you're not sure. Well, here's a timely reminder from Paul's letter to the Ephesians, which I've been reading this week, with just something to reflect on. So this is from Ephesians chapter 3, and the title in the Message Bible is "The Secret Plan of God." So we'll finish with this today. He says, "As you read over what I have written to you, you'll be able to see for yourselves into the mystery of Christ. None of our ancestors understood this. Only in our time has it been made clear by God's Spirit through his holy apostles and prophets of this new order. The mystery is that people who have never heard of God and those who have heard of him all their lives, what I've been calling outsiders and insiders, they stand on the same ground before God. They get the same offer, the same help, the same promises in Christ Jesus. The message is accessible and welcoming to everyone across the board." I really hope you enjoy our service today.
Bye. I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my turn till I made. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my turn, yeah, till I made. You call my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day. You call my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness.
And Sally were scarecrow twins, one boy and one girl, born on the same day, each as lovely as each other and special as each other too. And both had a great job to do, to scare away the crows so that they don't eat the precious seed that the farmer has sown. Just like all twins, perhaps, they didn't always agree. Sammy felt the best way to keep the birds away was to wave his hands. Sally said there was no need to do that. In fact, there was no need to do anything. All they had to do was to simply stand there. That was scary enough. Their mother used to say, "Oh, do stop arguing. You both are right. Just be happy that you have such an important job to do and get on with it." Sammy is actually a really nice lad who cares about his sister a lot. Sometimes when the birds swoop down all at once and Sally is a little bit scared, Sammy says to her, "Stand firm, Sal. Don't be afraid. Remember the farmer? He will help us to be brave." "But Sam," says Sally, "I saw on the telly a really scary film where there were so many birds and they covered the poor scarecrow and pulled out all of their straw. And that was the end of him."
That's the trouble with you, Sal. You watch things that are not good for you. You need to watch and think about things that make you feel good. That way you won't be frightened and you'll stay positive. Come on, we can do this. The farmer believes in us. We've got a great job, and if things get difficult, he will be there to help us.
Do you know, that story reminds me of a letter that a man called Paul wrote to some Christians in a place called Philippi. You can actually find that. It's a book in the Bible in the New Testament. His advice to the Christians there at Philippi was a bit like Sam's advice to Sally. So think of Sam being Paul and think of Sally being the Christians and think of the farmer being God. And this was Paul's advice to the Christians. Stand firm in the Lord. Agree with each other. Rejoice in the Lord always. Don't worry. Instead, pray and God will help you and give you peace. Think about good things and do good things. Be content with whatever happens to you and believe that God knows all about it and he will give you the strength to cope. Our God is a great big God and he holds us in his hands. Don't forget that. Bye for now. Bye.
Good morning. My name's Jan, and I've been asked to lead the prayers this morning. I'd like to read you a prayer I found in the Barnabas Aid magazine, and it's a meditation on the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, who alone knows our brokenness and pain, who honours us by making us your children, equal members of your family, and gives us a new identity as your beloved chosen people. Hallowed be your name, for you are pure and sinless. You are the great I Am, before whom we stand in awe, a God of truth and righteousness, a God of mercy and justice. Your kingdom come, let your glorious rule cover the earth and banish all injustice. Cast out all corruption and right all wrongs. Set your people free from oppression and let your reign begin in us. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Help us to accept your purposes, your good and perfect plan for our lives, as one day all creation will submit and bow before you, in whom is perfect peace and freedom. Give us today our daily bread, for we are poor and needy, and we depend on you. Father, provide our food and water, our clothing and shelter. Day by day, may our eyes look to you. And forgive us our debts, as we have forgiven our debtors. Father, forgive our many sins, through the shed blood of Jesus, your Son, who died for us and rose again. Release us from the burden of our debts and give us grace to forgive those in debt to us. Father, make us generous and merciful people. And lead us not into temptation. Father, give us faith to overcome our fears, doubts, and worries. Father, do not test us more than we can bear, but give us strength to endure patiently, the grace to accept and persevere. Give us a life of godliness and contentment. But deliver us from the evil one. Father, rescue us from Satan's wiles. Free us from his bondage. Snatch us from calamity, death, and the injustice of evil men. For yours is the kingdom, the glory and the power. Father, establish your sovereign rule, glorify your name, and keep us safe, now and for eternity. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I am here at the Community Centre on this brilliant sunny morning, and I'm here to give you an update very briefly on what's happening next Sunday. If you have never been to Glebe before and you're considering coming, then if you drive around the back, you will be met by this lovely car park. We have parking here, and there's parking down at the bottom here as well, and then we have some disabled parking spaces here as well, so please make use of them. You can come in this back door. At the front there, it will be a door that has a ramp as well that you can use. If you're driving, you come in the back door. We're not going to insist that anyone wears a mask. However, we are going to ask that it would be great if you could, when you're coming in and going out, put masks on just to keep everyone safe. This door is a little bit tight, and it can be a pinch point on Sundays for those of you who come to our services regularly. When we had them in person, then you'll know that can be a pinch point. So when we're coming and going, it would be great if we could just encourage you to wear a mask. If you're not able to wear a mask for whatever reason, then don't feel pressured to. And I think as a church, we'll understand and be gracious to one another, depending on whichever choice we make. Track and trace will be optional. Again, we're not expecting everyone to do it if you don't have a smartphone, etc. But if you would like to do it, then that would be brilliant. There will be QR codes. We would encourage everyone to use the hand sanitizer on the way in if possible. Again, for a medical reason, etc., if you're not able to use it, then that's fine. But we are just, the message is we're trying to be clear, is we want to meet together, we want to meet and worship God, and we want to show each other as much love and grace as possible. And so if that means wearing a mask and being a bit uncomfortable to protect others, then that's what you feel you need to do, then that's what you need to do. But equally, if you're unable to wear a mask, we don't want you to feel like the odd one out. We don't want you to feel criticized in any way. Please come as you are, and let's just remember to keep each other safe. Where possible, we would encourage people to distance to reduce the chance of COVID being an issue. Now, I have mentioned, I think, that we're going to sing, and that is exciting. I'm very much looking forward to it. So when you come in, you will come in through this back door and straight ahead into the main hall. Now, the setup in here is we're going to have rows of chairs out as normal. So there's going to be no space side to side. That's not going to be spaced any differently. However, we are going to space them with more depth so that when we do stand up to sing, you're not breathing straight into the back of somebody's neck. So we will have more distance between the chairs. We'll also have little cards that say, please give space. And if you are concerned about somebody sitting next to you, not somebody specifically, but if you're concerned about people sitting next to you because you are vulnerable or you're just worried, then you can pick one of these cards up and pop it on the chairs, on one chair each side of you, so that people will know that you just need a bit of extra space. And I would encourage you to do that if that's the case. If you are coming and you don't mind people sitting next to you, you're not concerned, then just don't put the card next to you, and people will know that you're okay with them sitting next to you. Again, we don't have a clue how many of you are coming. We don't know if we'll have a full hall or just 10 or 15 or 20. So please, let's just be really gracious to one another in space. Let's be really gracious to one another in how we need to do this, recognizing that not everyone will feel excited to be back, and also recognizing that some people will be really excited to be back. So the service, we will be singing. Again, it's up to you whether you wear a mask when you're doing it or not. We will be doing prayers together. We will be having a sermon. Sunday clubs will be running. So we will have a group of primary school age, sort of 3 or 4 plus, going upstairs to do some activities. And then we'll have a teenagers group going out as well to do some activities. We will also be providing a creche as well for the sermon part. So for the first half of the service, if everyone stays in, and then the second half for the sermon, and it'll be some boring preacher with a ginger beard will be giving you a sermon. So if you're a young person and that sounds unappealing, then you can go out to those Sunday clubs, or of course you can stay in as well. What we would say is again, just use the hand sanitizer. We want to reduce physical contact as much as possible. So it might feel strange not shaking hands or hugging or even laying hands on when praying. But we would ask you just not to do that, because we want to reduce the chance of COVID being transmitted as much as is possible. So the message again is that we want to show love to one another. We want to show grace to one another. And we want to come here and enable everyone to worship God together. We're looking forward to seeing you on the 25th. Just to say as well, we're not having a booking in system, so it's just turn up as you are. In the other room, just across the hallway, we'll see if I can walk in there. My arm is getting very sore from holding this camera up, so I'll make this quick. So if you are really concerned about being in a large hall with lots of people, then this space here with the television will also be available, with less chairs in it, more of a space between them. And we'll hopefully have a relay through of the service into here. And so if you are very concerned about coming in and sitting in a room with lots of people, then you can come through here and you can have a bit of a less confined space, a bit more space between you and other people, and you can hopefully worship with us. We will not have refreshments after the services in August. We would encourage you to, if you would like to chat after the services, to make use of the car park and go outside and chat. We'd also encourage you to invite people back to your homes, go to local restaurants or places where you can eat if you want to see people and have fellowship with them. But again, the message is that none of these rules are necessarily compulsory under law, but we just want to make sure that we love one another when we come to worship, and that we give space and we allow people to come and worship regardless of their views of masks or COVID or social distancing or any of that. So we would advise caution, like the government are, but we are really, really keen to be back and to be worshiping God together. So I look forward to seeing you on Sunday.
Hello everyone, it's Lois and Kez here. So grab your words, we're going to sing again, and we're going to start with a song I sang a few weeks ago called Take Heart. So it'd be really great to sing this together and learn it as a church.
Good morning, everyone. It's me again. It was announced today that Rupert was going to speak. I'm very sorry. Rupert actually told me months ago that he couldn't speak today, and I didn't tell anyone. So apologies. But you've got me today and me again next week. You'll have someone else after that, though. Don't worry. But it's good to be here. I'm quite glad that this is hopefully for some time the last one of these with me in my office looking at a camera, speaking to I don't know who watching this. But this is our hopefully our last one like this. I'm sure you can see the decline in my attempts to both make myself personally look smart and the environment behind me. It's going to be the last time, hopefully, you're going to see my little friend here. He doesn't have a name yet. If you want to name him, feel free. But, you know, I think we've had quite a big achievement doing these online services. They're not perfect, but I think they really represent what kind of a church we are and what we stand for. We've had we've got over 81 videos on our YouTube channel just the month before COVID. I think we had one. They've all been of a really high standard. We've averaged 1,000 views a month. And I think we've not only had a good quality of video produced, but the content I think has been great. And I think ultimately what has been said and what has been communicated has been brilliant. I really believe we have captured the essence of Glebe Chapel over the last 18 months on these online services. A church where everyone mucks in, where everyone gets involved. And ultimately it's about encouraging each other to worship God and to study his word. Now we've thanked people before, but I just really wanted to say thank you again to Dave Farrance for spending not hours, but days each week editing this footage together. Thank you for your patience for when we've not videoed in the right way or in the right format or anything else. It took me months to realize that actually my phone had a setting for recording in the right format for YouTube. So thank you, Dave, for having so much patience with us and doing all that you've done. Thank you to Lois for creating rotas, chasing up videos, being the inspiration behind interviews and a lot of the stuff that goes on online. Tim Dexter for creating the worship videos. They've been brilliant with different people popping up on the screen. That will not have taken a short amount of time. That'll have been some effort. So thank you so much for that, Tim. Thank you to Jody for sending out the emails and the links and all of the other stuff that Jody took on because I was forgetting to do. And thank you for Ruth for keeping our social media active and making sure that ticks over. And there's so many more of you that we need to thank and for making this happen. It's really been a lifeline for a lot of people. So thank you very much. We're actually talking today in Philippians 4, and it talks about giving. Paul is talking about giving to his work and how it shows where their heart is, and it's a wonderful aroma, fragrance to God when we give to his work. And you guys and many more of you who've been involved in this and who've conquered fears of technology. Yes, thinking of you, Rupert, fears of technology. Fears of presenting online and having to watch yourself back. All of that is giving time and energy and emotional carrying a burden for your brothers and sisters so that we can do church during a time that is has been unprecedented, unheard of for generations. So thank you. And thank you to everyone who's involved in setting up as well. The church starting a week today, huge, huge job getting it up and running. Much, much bigger than I ever imagined it being. You can probably see the bags under my eyes. So thank you everyone who's involved in that, and really looking forward to it. Now, on to today's reading, today's message. Philippians 4. For some reason, some numpty who came up with this series, it was me, by the way, who came up with this series, decided to just lump Philippians 4 as a whole chapter into 1 week. You can see why I gave it to Rupert to speak this week originally. But I dumped the whole of chapter 4 into our final week here, and it is a much meatier, when I reread it, it's a much meatier chapter than I remembered when I made the series. And so it's Paul who's now a little bit older in his ministry. He's writing to a church from prison, thinking that he could be executed, he could remain in prison, that could be his ministry done. He just doesn't know. And it's a final chapter, and he's speaking really passionately, and there's almost a disconnection in the way he's writing. It's just Paul straight from the heart, almost like his retirement speech or a father of a bride speech, where they just want to get what really matters, what's really burdening them, what's really in their heart to say to these people across. And I'm trying to deal with that in 1 week. Now, fortunately, for starting back next week, I'd given a free hand. And so I am going to take what I think is the wise decision and split Philippians 4 into two sections. But I'm going to do it in reverse order. Today, I'm going to speak on Philippians 4, verses 10 to 23. And then next week, I'll look at verses 1 to 9. And the reasoning behind this is that I just feel like verses 1 to 9 fits being together a lot more than 10 to 23. It suits us to be talking about love and community and grace and love for one another and love for God, and how then we do that when we're actually together and in the same space and as one. And so today we're going to look at Philippians 4, 10 to 23. So let's read it first, and then we'll look at it and see what we can learn from it. So Philippians chapter 4, and I'll set up a bit. Here we go. So Philippians chapter 4, verses 10 through to the end, 10 to 23. It says, I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now, after some time, you have received your concern for me. You were indeed concerned for me, but you had no opportunity to show it. Now that I am speaking of being in need, not that I am speaking of being in need, for I have learned in whatever situation I am to be content. I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound. In any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Yet it was kind of you to share my trouble. And you, Philippians yourselves, know that at the beginning of the gospel, when I left Macedonia, no church entered into partnership with me in giving and receiving except you alone. Even in Thessalonica, you sent me help for my needs once and again. Not that I seek the gift, but I seek the fruit that increases to your credit. I have received full payment and more. I am well supplied, having received from Epaphroditus the gifts you sent, a fragrant offering, a sacrifice acceptable and pleasing to God. And my God will supply every need of yours according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. To our God and Father be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Greet every saint, every believer in Christ Jesus. The brothers and sisters who are with me greet you, and the saints greet you, especially those from Caesarea's household. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you and be with your spirit. It is a very heartfelt message. Now, Paul, if you're unsure who Paul is, if you're just joining us for the first time today, or you're not too sure about who Paul is, Paul is an apostle. So he is somebody chosen by God to go and to plant churches and to support churches in the first century. Just, you know, these are some of the first churches ever planted. And so Paul had planted this church in Philippi. He knew the people well, and he himself is now in prison. It might seem like a bit of a strange passage to focus on. It might even feel like it's just a long sign off from Paul sending them a thank you card for a gift that they've sent. But once we start to look at some of the detail and some of the single verses in it, we find it's really very revealing and also very challenging in how we live our lives. And more so than that, it's part of God's word. And so if it's in there, then God cares about it, and so should we. So a very quick summary of where we are in reading this passage, a quick summary of who Paul is. So Paul was originally a Jew who hated Christianity. He had a miraculous conversion, which you can read about in the book of Acts. And then he sets his sights, his whole purpose in life, of fulfilling God's calling on his life, the purpose that God has set on his heart. And that is to tell as many people as possible about Jesus by setting up churches on various mission trips across parts of Europe, the Mediterranean, and sections of Asia. And he mentions in this Macedonia and Thessalonica and then Philippi, the church he's writing to in this book, all places where Paul travelled and met believers and brought them to Jesus. And Paul had a specific role as an apostle to speak into the lives of people and the churches, a bit like a respected friend who you know lives a very strong life, a Christian life, a believer who has so much wisdom and knowledge and understanding and has walked with God for many, many years. And he is gifted in speaking into these churches' lives by unpacking God's word and instructing them in how to live and how to be as a community, as a body of believers. Now, Paul worked sometimes. We know from his letters and from Acts and from other places in Scripture that he did work sometimes for money to be able to feed himself and to live. Other times he relied on support and gifts being given to him, like we read about here in Philippi. And we see in Corinthians that sometimes he was paid to speak, paid for the work that he had done. Although in many instances he turned that down. Now in our culture, money can be a funny thing. We all need it. We all have some money, whether it's a little or a lot, but we don't really like to talk about it much. It can be seen as boastful or inappropriate or sometimes embarrassing. And it's often, and it wasn't too different. It was very similar in Paul's day. Yet we recognise that people like Paul, both then and now, who have given all of their life to God, regardless of the financial impact, all of their time, all of their energy to share in the gospel, and who are gifted in running, planting churches, discipling people, teaching and preaching and other gifts. It's recognised both then and now that they need money to survive. We need money. We need finances, and we need food, and we need water, and we need all of these things. So we know that the Christians in Philippi had recognized that, and they had sent gifts of money to Paul. One seems to be fairly recent, since Paul is writing back to them to thank them for it, and it looks like it's enabled him to live and to travel and to be able to afford the things that he needs in life. It looks like it's been some time, though, since they have made contact with him. It says right at the beginning there in verse 10. Excuse me. I was pleased to have received your concern. Now, that's a bit of a funny way of saying I'm pleased to have heard from you. I'm pleased to have received this gift. And he recognizes that they wanted to, but they had no way of getting it through to him. And he very quickly and very delicately follows that by explaining that he was not really concerned about his own living conditions. Although he is very welcoming of the gift and thanking them for it, he was never looking for a gift from them. But he recognizes that they had a heart to share in his trouble. What a wonderful verse. They have a heart to share in his trouble. And that's the first thing I took from this when I read it. The heart issue here. Clearly, Paul is welcoming of this gift. He's not asking for more, but he is welcoming of the gifts that he's received. He is rejoicing, not in receiving the financial gift, although he's clearly happy about it, but he is rejoicing that it shows where their hearts lie. It shows where the essence of their heart sits. And it's in sharing in his trouble and stretching their own faith. He writes, "I seek the fruit that increases your credit." Interesting verse in this translation. Maybe an easier translation would have a better way of putting it. But what he's saying is, I seek you. He's recognizing that the fruit in their life will increase by giving up what they have to God's work. It's an offering, he writes later on, acceptable to God, no more so, not just acceptable, but pleasing to God. It's clear that Paul is trying to politely say that he really appreciates the gift personally, although he has learned to be happy in having very little stuff and money, and even to be happy in his hunger. Yet at the same time, help the people that have sent the gift in Philippi to realize the benefit and effect it will have on the givers as much as it will on the receiver. Now, this is where we need to be careful. Verse 19, it says, "And my God will supply every need of yours according to his riches in glory." So this church sends Paul a financial gift. They give out of their own money. And the way Paul is writing here, it seems to be clear that it's not a small amount of money. He's clearly insinuating that these people have really given, to their detriment, their personal detriment financially. Paul receives it and notes the benefit to the givers as well as to himself. And then he says, God will supply their every need. Now, if we look at this like a formula, like a mathematical formula, then the more I give, the more God will supply for me and the more blessed I will be. Now, we tend to get into trouble when we break one or two verses from Scripture down into a formula and think it will bring us success. It never ends well. Paul has centered his letter to the Philippians about being light of the world. The letter as a whole about being the light of the world, about having a Christian community that is set apart in how we act and what we believe, but yet still embedded in the world so that we can be that light in spiritually dark places. Paul has explored various heart issues, various issues that, you know, that are at the core of our being in this letter. And this is another one, except this one really pleases him. It's the love for fellow believers, the recognition in their gifting and ultimately their personal sacrifice to allow the word of God to be preached and to be taken across the Roman Empire, that is pleasing to Paul. That's what pleases Paul and pleases God in this passage. It could have been a gift of anything. It could have been people to join him. It could have been food. It could have been several different things. It's not the money itself that's given. It's not even the value that he notes of the money that's given that pleases him and pleases God, but it's the reason that it's been given. The recognition that the more we lean into God and rely on him and give of ourselves, of all that we have, finances, our time, our energy, our very being, the more he gives us what we need. Now, we might need a spell of hunger, as Paul says, a spell of insecurity in our job situation to rely on God and all the more sharpen our faith. It might be a spell of prosperity to enable us to be generous to others or to do something for God that we couldn't do if we were short of money. It might be a period of extra time with which we can invest into his kingdom, a period of of more energy or less energy, a period of difficulty or a period of rejoicing. God gives us all we need in our lives, in every area of our lives. He gives us all we need to survive, yes, but more importantly, he gives us all we need to learn to rely fully on Jesus and to hold him at the forefront of our mind as our saviour. Paul writes, to live is Christ and to die is gain. We get this impression when we read Paul's letters of this fundamental guy who has given everything to Jesus and where the focal point of all of his life is worshipping God and telling others about Jesus. We sometimes meet these people that are radically driven towards one thing and everything else falls at the side. We tend to call them mavericks, and we see them in business and in sport and in all of these other things where their whole life is just centered on one purpose and one goal, and everything else is just kind of bump that goes alongside it. And we get that impression from Paul. His whole life is focused on following God. And so in receiving a gift, he is pleased because he doesn't have to go hungry, but he is even more pleased that their credit increases their spiritual formation, and where their heart is revealed. So the question for us is why do we do what we do? For more established churchgoers, those of you who have been coming your whole lives, the question maybe to pose ourselves is, why do we come to church? What does our heart tell us about that? Do we go to church to offer our time to God in worship, to build up fellow believers and to support those exploring faith for the first time? Or do we go because we need to? Because it's what we've always done? Because it's the expectation of our parents or our spouse? Because it's part of our weekly routine? Church is a good place to be. And I would never discourage somebody from coming, but we need to search our hearts and ask the question, why do we do what we do? Is it in the interest, our own selfish interest? Or is it the interest, or are we interested in furthering our relationship with God? God is interested in our heart that drives our actions, not our actions alone. We could extend that into, why do we read our Bibles every day? Is it to seek to learn about Jesus, to grow closer to him, to encourage us to sacrifice more of ourselves in the kingdom of God? Or is it because it makes us look clever at home group? Or to earn something from God? If I read my Bible enough, God will give it to me. I'm afraid not. Or perhaps because it's just the way we've been brought up and we've never thought about it before. If we do it because we're simply taught to do it, or because we want to earn our salvation, or because it's the done thing, or because of our own selfish desires, we become religious like the Pharisees and we lose the heart of the gospel. We need to search our hearts and ask ourselves why. In this specific context of giving that Paul is talking, why do I give? Is it because I want to share in the troubles of other believers? I want to take on the burden of the missionaries myself in my own financial life so that they don't have to do it alone? Is it because I want to practice and really demonstrate sacrificial love? Am I looking to grow God's kingdom? And if it is, and that is the reason you are doing these things, then praise God. And please keep going. God loves a cheerful giver. But if it's because you just do, because you've just always done, or perhaps want to be recognized as a good person, or for whatever else it might be that is ultimately looking to please yourself, then we need to stop and rethink our motives. And what better time to do it than with the reopening of church over this next week, to stop and rethink our motives about why we are doing things. Is it to create a pleasing fragrance, as Paul writes, for ourselves? Or is it to create a pleasing fragrance and aroma for God? Where are our hearts? And Paul himself has clearly experienced sacrificing for God's kingdom. His life of travelling, being imprisoned, shipwrecked. When you read through Acts, he had a hard life. His testimony is enough. But yet, he has learned to be content with whatever he has. Verses 11 through to 13 are incredibly powerful and challenging. It says, "Not that I am speaking of being in need, for I have learned in whatever situation I am to be content and know how to be brought low and know how to abound, how to have much. In any circumstances, I have learned the secret of facing plenty and facing hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me." Paul has learned to do without the very basics in life and to live a life pleasing to God. He's also learned to live a life pleasing to God when he has been blessed with many things. He does it through the strength Jesus gives him. And when we read Acts about Paul's calling to serve God, it is clear what he needs to do with his life. We all have a calling under God, and it is vital that we seek God in everything we do, putting aside our wants and needs to follow him. Because what we need, no matter what faces us, Christ gives us the strength to do it. That is Paul's secret: to know God's will for his life and to follow it. And Paul means when he says, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me," is I can do all things that God has called me to do through Christ who strengthens me. We so easily get that wrong. Now, I wanted to play rugby for a living at one point in my life. I think I was on track to do it. I was in the right system. I think I was good enough. I was already earning money from doing it. And I prayed and I prayed and I prayed to God to ask him to give me the strength to do it. And this verse spoke a lot into it. "I can do anything who Christ strengthens me," inspired me to tackle guys twice my size, to work harder in the gym, to run harder at training, to get fitter, to get more skillful, to be better, because I believed that Christ would strengthen me to do it. And I think for some time he did. It's been a formative part of who I am. But I did all of that. I ran harder, lifted more in the gym, trained more often than anyone else in the team, because I wanted to pursue my dream. But that's the point. It was my dream. And when it all came crashing down around me, I had to sit up and take note that this was not God's will for my life. And it was really, really hard to come to terms with. Your life's plan pulled out from under you. Even worse, the plan that you were sure God would back you in doing, having to recognize that ultimately it was my plan in life, my selfish ambition, and recognize that I had been self-centered from the beginning, saying, "It's my life, I can do with it what I please." I was good at rugby and I felt good doing it. Yet in the back of my mind, I knew God had other plans for me, and it's not a natural fit for me. This isn't a natural fit for me. You've probably noticed. Reading and writing are not my strong points. Organisation is poor, to say the least. I have low confidence. My time management struggles. People skills, well, they are very Scottish, in case you've noticed. Yet this is what God has called me to do. And that's the same story of Christians the world over, most of whom have had far more against them than I have, and have made far bigger of an impact on the world for Jesus than I have. Because when we follow God's call in our lives, no matter how daunting or difficult or financially unrobust, no matter how financially difficult it is, if we trust God will supply for our every need, and trust that he will give us what we need, not what we want, then we can be content. And it's probably the hardest part of Christian life. Before we were believers, before we sought God's call on our lives, there was one person working against us, and that was God. He has a plan for us, and he steers us towards it. But he is loving, and he is gentle, and he is gracious, and he deeply, deeply loves us, and so he moved us in our lives to come and meet with him. Once you follow his will, once you become a Christian and you start seeking his will, we gain more enemies. What the Bible calls the flesh trying to trip us up, our selfish desires trying to trip us up and move us away from God. The devil and his armies are against us when we follow Jesus. And the world, a world full of people who do not understand your life in Jesus Christ. And it's hard. Yet don't take it from me that God cares for you and will see you through. Take it from Paul in his words in Philippians. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. And God is more powerful than all of the world, your flesh and the devil put together. In Romans, Paul writes about how when we come to Christ, we cannot be plucked from God's hand. He has us securely there. If we focus on Jesus and God's will in our lives, none of the enemies of God will pluck us out of his hand. And then we have the final greetings here in verses 21 and 22. Brothers and sisters, the brothers and sisters with me greet you. In all of Paul's writings, the theme of church unity and love is at the forefront. It's so important we walk this walk together, supporting one another when we need to. In fact, not just when we need to, but whenever we can. From a heart of love and a heart focused on growing God's kingdom, on establishing ourselves together in this world as ambassadors of Jesus. Now, next week, when we do meet together in person, let's remember that. We are there to worship God, even if it feels strange and unusual, to focus our heart on Jesus. And while we are together in the same room, to encourage one another to walk in God's will in a world that will not make it easy for us. As I was preparing this and thinking about how to end, I came to Romans 8, verse 6, and it says, "For to set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace." To set the mind on the Spirit of God is life and peace. And I just wanted to end with that as we think about next week and maybe the anxieties and the difficulties of coming together. As we think about maybe being challenged in how we use our money today, how we use our time and our energy and all of the challenges that Paul's writing bring to us. Let's just remember that if we focus on God, focus on his Spirit and encourage it in our lives, we will have life and peace. A contentment in our calling in God and fulfilling what God has called us to do in our lives. Let's just pray and then we'll go into our final song of hopefully our final online only service. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for your word and we thank you for your church. We thank you for this writing that we have written by the hand of Paul but inspired by our holy God, our loving God. And Father, we pray that you would help us to understand your calling in our lives. Make it clear to us as we're listening, Lord. And those who have been troubled by not knowing what their calling is in their life before God, just, Father, may your Spirit make it abundantly clear to them. Make it really clear to those who are puzzling over what you want them to do with their life, Lord. And not just that, but give them through the power of your Spirit, through believers around them and through the understanding of your word, a clear path as to how to get there and how to do it. And Lord, we are always challenged when we read scripture about how we use our finances and our time and our energy and all of the resources that you've given us. And so Father, guide us in how we should do that. Lord, we rely on you for everything and we just want to recognize that before you. We want to recognize that if it wasn't for Jesus dying on the cross, all of that we have would be futile and pointless because ultimately we would be spiritually dead. And so we thank you that Christ died and rose again for us, and that we can have life and peace, not just now, but in the life to come as well. And so, Father, we thank you for who you are, and we pray that you would keep us safe and well as we gather next week, that we would that you would meet with us when we gather together next week, and we would feel the power of your Spirit moving in our hearts and our minds. Lord, make us more like Christ today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Worship His holy name.